Bren. Bren's goal is to help people learn about the relicensing process and get today our goal is to meet the government agencies that are going to be involved in, or parties to the licensing. So last time we talked a little bit about the process and how important it is to get people to participate in the process. And Liz videoed this last time and put it on the Bren Facebook page. So Barber Dam relicensing involves the dam itself, the reservoir, and the Hyde Park project that are all on the Boise River upstream of Eckert Bridge. The current license was issued in 1983 by the Federal Energy Regulatory Commission, and the co-licensees of the Barber Dam Hydroelectric Project are Fulcrum LLC, which is a subsidiary of Enel Green Power North America Incorporated, and Ada County. So a little background on the project, just to refresh. The project facilities were constructed by Barber Lumber Company in 1904-1905 to provide a mill pond and power source for the company's sawmill. Barber Mill was periodically operated until it was dismantled in 1934. Ownership of the dam and the abandoned powerhouse changed several times until the mid-1970s, when due to a failure to pay taxes, Ada County was required to take ownership of the project. The FERC license is dated December 23, 1983, and it allowed for the construction, operation, and maintenance of a new power project on Barber Dam, which involved restoration and modifications to the powerhouse to accommodate new turbines. Fulcrum joined Ada County as a co-licensee in 1989 and operates and maintains the project under a lease agreement. The project has an installed capacity of 3.7 megawatts and consists of a 1,100-foot-long earthen embankment dam, a 400-foot-long, 25-foot-tall concrete-capped timber crib spillway section, a 75-acre impoundment, Barber Pool, with two bulkhead gate type intakes, two trash racks, a trash sluiceway, a powerhouse containing two 1.8 megawatt units, 100 foot concrete tailrace, 60 feet of underground transmission line that leads to a transformer, and the power is sold to Idaho Power Company. The current license expires in 2023, and as Liz said, the licensee is going to have its first stakeholder meeting March 15th of this year. I worked in relicensing at Idaho Power for, Idaho Parks and Recreation for 24 years, and have had a lot of background in relicensing. And that kind of concludes my portion of this. And now I get to introduce Mary McGowan.
In a previous life, I worked for Idaho Rivers United, and we were involved in relicensing Idaho Power's dams on the Upper Snake River, and started the Hell's Canyon relicensing process, which goes on today. So it's been decades. So as a nonprofit, you can be involved in the process, or as an individual, or as a non-governmental agency, through the governmental agencies that are kind of the balance to FERC. Because FERC can issue the license, or will issue the license, but it can be conditioned by the agencies, both federal and state. And there are mandatory conditions that the state can place on a license. So the best way for people to be involved is to be allied with one of the agencies that's involved. So the state agencies, again, are really important. One that's not represented today is Department of Environmental Quality. And if they deny certification based on water quality standards, FERC must deny a license. So there is a lot of, I wouldn't say necessarily power, but they are very, the agencies are very influential. Oh, it was the executive director, I have to make sure I get this right, of the Upper Snake River Tribes Foundation. Tribes and agencies are the ones who have the official conditioning authority on a FERC license. So, no further ado, Scott.
I can do your slides for you, okay?
Okay.
Can people see the slides okay? I'm not sure. If I. Somebody sees other light switches they wanna turn up and down, but we'll just go ahead like this. Get closer if you can't see it.
Good afternoon. My name is Scott Hauser and I'm the executive director of the Upper Snake River Tribes Foundation. We're located here in Boise. We're right downtown on 4th and Idaho Street. Thanks, Liz, for inviting me. And so a lot of what I'm gonna talk about really isn't necessarily specific to the Barber Dam, but just giving you kind of a sense of who we are and some of the policies that we have and the other projects we're working on that relate to the Barber Dam, and we will be involved in the Barber Dam relicensing process. So USERT was originally the idea for the Upper Snake River Tribes, I'll just say USERT moving forward, was created in 1998 by three of the four tribes, the Chopais, the Chobans, and the Burns Paiute. Fort McDermitt comes in later. It wasn't until 2008 that USERT was actually, the charter was created, and we became a 501c3 nonprofit and established an office here in Boise. Fort McDermitt Paiute Shoshone Tribe became a member in 2011. They're located, as you can see, right in the area of McDermitt, Nevada. And also, as you can see, the land base for each of the four tribes is quite diverse. The Burns Tribe only has 780 acre reservation. At one time, they had the largest reservation in Oregon. Now they have one of the smallest reservations in Oregon. So you can go to the next one. And so many people, including myself, I was born and raised in Caldwell, left in the early, when the mid-90s, came back to take this job and started working for USERT in 2012. I was the environmental program director originally. I became the environmental program director, or the executive director, excuse me, in the fall of 2016. I was being raised in Caldwell. While we had Idaho history, Indian history was almost devoid, and it's still nearly absent in this valley. I travel all around to all places, all through the country, and for the most part, you find that cities, counties, communities are very proud of that Indian heritage. You don't find that in Boise. With that being said, I would say that the current mayor, Beter, and the council have been very supportive of the tribes, and they're trying to reach out to them. Currently, last year, there were two ceremonies on the steps of the City Hall. That has never happened before. Not once has that happened in Boise, and it happened twice last year. So that's very, very encouraging. But in 1864, there was the Treaty of Fort Boise. As you can see, it's unratified. It was never ratified by Congress. But if that treaty would have been ratified, all lands 30 miles of each side of the Boise River would have been tribal land. We wouldn't be sitting here right now. That wouldn't be a city. That wouldn't be a library. And, you know, it's hard to understand what it potentially would look like. But that treaty was never ratified. So now we have Boise as it is in its current place. But this area is the historic land of four tribes who are really the Shoshone, the Bannock, and the Paiute people. Now they've been cut up, and so we represent four tribes, but they're all related. They're all tied to one another. Even sad, even more sad that this treaty wasn't ratified within 20 years of the 1864 Fort Boise Treaty. All of those tribes were forcibly removed, killed, conscripted into the army to kill other tribes. And so it's a very, very, very sad history. But the tribes are still very proud to identify themselves as the original inhabitants of the Boise Valley. I would encourage all of you, the third week of June, it's called the Return of the Boise Valley People Gathering. It occurs out at Quarry View Park, which, another encouraging sign, the City Council will be voting this year to name that Castle Rock Park. And Castle Rock is a very, very culturally, spiritually important rock in that park. So hopefully, by the end of this month, the park will be renamed. Long-term vision is to have a cultural center built there as well. When me and my staff, we go out, we work for the tribes. This is a tribally created foundation. Often people think that we're a bunch of white people that are trying to save the Indians. No, we are white people who work for Indians that created this foundation. And so we're very careful when we go out in forums like this or meeting with feds or states, how we speak on behalf of the tribes. In 2016, we created the policy of the Upper Snake River Tribes Foundation for management of the Columbia and Snake River Basin resources. And this gives us marching orders. So as long as we stay within the boundaries of this policy, we can go out and speak for the tribes on their behalf. This is just a little excerpt from it. I have the full 3-page document in the back of the room. Please grab one. I also have brochures on our foundation. I think the most important thing is that we're working to restore the Columbian Snake Basin to as natural a condition as we can possibly get it back to. Now, in USERC's charter, it says to return to a natural condition. Unfortunately, that's not possible. So we had some very hard discussions that we need to make this a realistic policy, because we're going out and we're saying we're going to try to work to restore this to a natural condition, and that's just not going to happen, unfortunately. But we can work to make it as natural as possible. And that, so with issues like the Barber Dam come up, we can work within this policy. I've talked with my tribal leaders multiple times about Barber Dam, we haven't come with a position. I think it's safe to say that we would be advocating in part to certainly look at breaching of the dam. I'm not saying that's our official position, but that's something we would definitely encourage. It needs to be analyzed and analyzed fully. Going over, sorry. So some of the current hydro projects we're working on were a party in the Columbia River Treaty, which is a treaty between Canada and the United States. It's a coalition of 15 tribes in the Columbia Basin. The 15 Columbia Basin tribes have never worked together. It's highly unique. We're also involved in the Columbia River Systems Operation, which is reviewing 14 dams in the Columbia Basin. It's a court-ordered mandate given the disastrous biop after biop after biop that never are approved. It was supposed to be a 5-year process. Unfortunately, President Trump issued a memo in October, cutting it down to a 4-year process, which basically means we had 1 year of reviewing all the documents. Now we have maybe 15 days, and it's going to be a 5,000-page ES. Hell's Canyon has been mentioned. We're intimately involved in Hell's Canyon. Three of USERC's 4 tribes are interveners in the process. USERC is not an intervener. Anyone that's interested, February 12th is the due date to submit comments to ODEQ and IDEQ on 401. I would encourage you to do that. We're also part of the MAFAC. It's a group put together by NOAA Fisheries, and we're looking at developing quantitative and qualitative goals for salmon and steelhead in the basin. Finally, I'll just talk about this briefly, and please talk to me after if you want. We've developed a fisheries resource management plan to restore salmon and steelhead to the Snake River Basin. We're pushing very hard to get this included in the Hell's Canyon license in some arena. We've been working with Idaho Power for years. Those talks fell apart once the talks with Idaho and Oregon fell apart. But it has three goals: ceremonial fishery, a put and take, like what happens in the Boise River. We're looking at returning sustainable and harvestable populations of spring, summer Chinook, and steelhead in the Boise Bruno Jarbidge, Malheur, Owyhee, Payette, and Weezer Rivers. And then finally, the long-term goal is sustainable harvestable populations of fall Chinook in the main stem, Snake River. So be happy to talk to anybody more about any of this, and you can share the plan with us. It's been approved, it's been submitted to FERC, so it's a publicly available document. So appreciate it, thank you.
I'm Bill Bosworth. I don't have anything prepared to present today. I just want to give you a little view into my world and kind of how we play a role or not in the relicensing. I've been with Fish and Game for about 16 years and come from a wildlife background. About 21 years as a professional state biologist. Like I said, 16 here in Idaho. I'm not quite 1 year into the position I have now, which is an environmental staff biologist for the Southwest region. Fish and Game does not have management responsibilities in terms of permitting. All of our rules and administrative rules and regulations and state code give us regulatory authority over season setting. That falls to our commission. We are the implementation wing of the commission. So, with that in mind, our role in the realm of permitting and project review is to provide technical assistance. And so my position is within the technical assistance program. There's one of me in each of our seven regions in the state. And my region goes from Riggins to Nevada, Oregon, roughly to the crest of the Sawtooths. So a big chunk of property there. And I'm presented daily with dozens of comment opportunities on everything from local to state to federal agency permitting processes, planning, and project review. And we provide information regarding the fish and wildlife resources of the state to the permitting authority. So I'm a technical advisor to the permitting agencies, in this case FERC. And we serve at the request of that permitting agency and also their partners who are seeking information about how a proposed project will affect fish and wildlife resources. In some circumstances, those permitting agencies are required to consider fish and wildlife impacts in their permit process. And so we help the agencies understand what the implications of their decisions will be. And so in this particular project with Barber Dam relicensing, I'm not going to rubber stamp their application or permit. I simply provide information that helps inform that body. So with respect to Barber Dam, our primary interests are with Boise River Fisheries. Barber Dam is, and I apologize, I wasn't able to attend the first meeting on this, so don't know what you've been, if you attended that, which you've been told already. So apologies if I'm redundant here, but Barber Dam is a run-of-river dam, so basically water is supposed to go right on through. It's not something like Arrow Rock or Lucky Peak or Anderson, for that matter, where they're kind of a mixed management system. This is simply to provide power, and our interest is in how that the management of that dam and that power system affects downstream fisheries. and to a lesser extent, immediately upstream in Barber Pool, management of that system affects habitat conditions in Barber Pool. So fisheries is our primary concern, but we're also interested in the ramifications for riparian habitats, cottonwood forests, which is a very limited resource in Idaho in general, and particularly in the southwest part of the state, where we've got a very limited supply of big river systems and their associated riparian forests. And riparian forests and the river management are integrally tied together. And if we didn't have the proper management of the Boise River system, we would lose those cottonwood forests. In terms of fisheries, going back to that, it's a very important economically important fisheries for us. We've done some economic surveys that indicate Boise River fisheries contribute on the order of hundreds of thousands to millions of dollars to the local economies. And so it's both that environmental concern, recreational concern, and economic concern. So with that, I'll leave it at that and say if anything more for questions. I think.
So the next speaker is Tricia Kennedy from the State Historic Preservation Office, and I think a lot of times people don't realize that there is an agency that deals with the cultural and archaeological and historic resources. So,
thank you. Hello. Thank you for having me here today. I'm Tricia Kennedy. I'm the director of the State Historic Preservation Office here in Boise. We are a statewide office. We are part of the Idaho State Historical Society, which is a state agency founded in 1908. We are one of six work groups of the State Historical Society, but we are a small work group. We have 10 employees made up of primarily historians, architectural historians, planners, and archaeologists. What we do in the State Historic Preservation Office, and I'm going to clip that down to the SHPO, we are the SHPO, and that's how we call ourselves. We administer the provisions of the National Historic Preservation Act of 1966. Interestingly, the NHPA predates the Environmental Protection Act by 2 years. So we've been around since 1966 doing this work. And that law was really the first time that the federal government said that it will be a policy of the United States government to preserve our nation's cultural heritage. So that came out of large federal projects that more and more, increasingly, people were recognizing were having impacts to our communities and our historic resources and our historic and prehistoric resources. So specifically things like HUD urban renewal projects that were really gaining steam in the 1950s and 60s in particular, where downtowns in small communities were sort of being wholesale demolished and historic resources lost. We actually saw a lot of that happen here in Boise. There are a lot of empty lots in Boise when I first moved here in 1995 that were sort of left over from that urban renewal period in our state. Also, things like Bureau of Reclamation dam constructions and Army Corps of Engineer dam constructions, those were recognized as having impacts particularly on archaeological resources. One of the reasons that they impact archaeological resources is because, of course, they're on waterways, and we all love water, and so did Native Americans and our Native peoples, because that's really the life source of everything. And so you've got archaeological sites all along waterways throughout the state and the country, and when you build a large dam project that inundates sites, erosion occurs and destroys archaeological sites. So those were the kinds of projects that were being recognized more and more as having impacts to cultural resources. And there's this sort of grassroots groundswell to do something about that. And the outcome was the National Historic Preservation Act. So the Act has a number of program areas that we administer. One of the first things, of course, is protecting those resources. So there's a section of the National Historic Preservation Act called Section 106. And what that essentially says is that if a federal agency has an undertaking that has the potential to impact cultural resources, then they must consult with the State Historic Preservation Office to try to find ways to avoid, minimize, or mitigate any impacts to those cultural resources. So one of the first questions is, you know, well, what do we preserve? What's worth preserving? How do we know what needs to be preserved? So the Act also created the National Register of Historic Places, and our office administers that program for the state of Idaho on behalf of the National Park Service. The National Register is essentially the national list of those properties considered important in our past and worthy of preservation. So we evaluate properties for their eligibility to the National Register, and then in terms of federal projects, how they might be impacted by those federal projects through Section 106. So, in a nutshell, the process that a federal agency is required to go through, Section 106 is a federal agency's responsibility. If they have an undertaking, and an undertaking for the purposes of Section 106 is the use of any federal funds, licenses, or permits, or work on federal land. So in this case, when we're talking about FERC licensing or relicensing, that's a federal license that's going to be issued by a federal agency. So that undertaking, the first question is, does it have the potential to impact cultural resources? And if it does, then they need to begin this consultation process with our office. FERC licensing and relicensing is considered an undertaking that has potential to impact cultural resources because, again, dams and their potential erosive effects can have on archaeological sites, but also at this point, in our state's history, we certainly are seeing the dams themselves have become historic. So what is historic in terms of National Register eligibility? We look at there, you know, there's a lot of nuance to it, but essentially, in a nutshell, a property needs to be at least 50 years old. It needs to have historic architectural or archaeological integrity, and it needs to meet one of four criteria that the Park Service establishes that either important for its association to historical trends, important for its association with persons important in our past, an important work of engineering or architecture, or archaeological sites that have the potential to yield information important in our past. So we evaluate, we consult with federal agencies. About half of our five-person staff is full-time working with federal agencies to consult on projects. We consult with all federal agencies, even things like FDIC, where, you know, like the Federal Deposit Insurance Corporation. How is that, you know, impacted, and how does Section 106 come into that? While sometimes these banks are housed in historic buildings, and maybe they want to put an ATM machine on the outside of their building, and so they have to consult with us to try to minimize any impacts to that potential historic property. So we review about 1,200 projects a year with federal agencies, and most of them probably there are no impacts to the properties, and they're quickly you know, finished off. But things like FERC relicensing, that's a very large and complex project, and we look closely at the potential for, again, that erosive quality that the inundation might have to potential archaeological sites. And in this case, the Barber Dam itself and Powerhouse and the archaeological site, the historic archaeological site of where the mill itself was located, are already listed in the National Register of Historic Places. So those were listed in, I think, 1979. So we have been dealing with this property for a little while. We did review the original license in 1983 with I couldn't get at the records because those are long ago, sent over to our archives. but we did review it. That was pretty early days in our program. There probably wasn't a lot of activity with that review. The program's a little more sophisticated these days. But one thing we did look at, I think one of your questions was, have we dealt with this project before? We did in, for instance, 2014, there was a project to upgrade the spillway on the dam, and we did review that project and had a project finding of no adverse effect, so the project moved forward. One thing I want to be very clear about is that this law, the National Historic Preservation Act, does not give us the authority to stop a project ever. All it says is that the federal agency must consult with us. They must take into consideration the effects that their project is going to have on cultural resources, and then it is up to the federal agency to make the decision about how to proceed or not proceed. If an adverse effect is going to take place, then we go through a consultation process to discuss how they will mitigate that adverse effect, because they are required to mitigate any adverse effects. And mitigation can take many forms. For instance, back in 2006, over in eastern Idaho, the Cove Dam was decommissioned and removed, and our office consulted on that because that was a historic dam as well. So in the mitigation for the removal of that historic property was that the dam was fully documented to historic engineering record. That's a National Park Service level of recordation, and they kept the powerhouse building itself because that was a unique structure, even though they removed the dam. They did some interpretation of the site, talking about the importance of that dam in the agricultural history of the region. So, you know, there are lots of ways to mitigate adverse effects, and that's what we work with federal agencies to do. So I'll leave it at that. It's very complicated, but if anyone has any questions, we'd be happy to answer.
Spend a whole lot of time with some of these slides I put together. I think you'd be more interested in the photographs I was able to pull out from our archives. I'm an engineer with the Water Resources Department, and the Water Resources Department has divisions that deal with water rights, stream channel protection. Mary is familiar with the National Flood Insurance Program, groundwater, and the Idaho Water Resource Board is kind of joined at the hip with the Water Resources Department, but it's more of a commission in the form of Fish and Game. So that said, if you want to get on to our website, there's lots of information there. I won't put that up here for you to look at, but the state is coordinating comment on the relicensing through the Attorney General's Office, Christine Fugate, Natural Resources Attorney. She'll be collecting responses on behalf of DEQ, Fish and Game, Water Resources. That's not to say that other state agencies won't have comments. They may, but as far as the natural resources piece of the state goes, she's the contact person. I think I'll just go ahead. I've worked for the Water Resources Department 12 years. We have four division offices, one in Coeur d'Alene, another one here in Boise. I'm not sure how that worked out. One in Twin Falls and one in Idaho Falls. So why don't we just start clicking through these slides, and I'll get to the ones that I think you'd be most interested in. We just keep going.
Yeah. Oh, this is all on your website, huh?
Yes, it is.
Yeah.
The important thing is Barber Dam is a smallish structure in terms of the dams that we regulate compared to the one just upstream, Lucky Peak. It's a bit of a blip. However, it is regulated by the state. And it's also regulated for dam safety purposes by FERC. And because they produce power and put it on the grid, they're required to have a power license, and thus the reason for the relicensing. Go ahead to the next one. We'll go one more. We classify the dam as a significant hazard structure, meaning if it were to fail catastrophically, there could be damage to downstream property. It's unlikely there would be loss of life, which is a high hazard. And as the previous slide mentioned, hazard is not the same as risk. Hazard is the potential. A big rock sitting on top of the hill, you could say, is high hazard. It could be mobilized in a seismic event, roll down the hill and squash somebody. So it's that kind of a distinction. Go to the next one, please. We're getting into some photographs here. You've probably all seen the nameplate on the powerhouse. Please.
Yes, thank you.
There's a view of the powerhouse recently taken. You see the two turbines?
Oh,
you're fine. The two turbines, 1.8 megawatt production each. We'll go to the next one. Brief history, 1882. Moses Godwin builds the first lumber mill, permanent lumber mill in Boise area. 1883, the first log drive down the Boise River. These weren't small logs, by the way. These were old growth trees, in excess of 200 tons per tree. Think about that for a minute. 1902, the Goodwin Lumber Mill was sold to Pagemont Lumber Company. Some people call it Paintmont, and I was P-A-T-E. I was unable to find out the correct name of that. So if someone out there knows, let me know and I'll get that corrected. In 1904, design was approved by a state engineer, which is now the Water Resources Department, for construction of a timber creek dam on the Boise River. 1905, Barber Dam was completed. In 1909, the Boise Diversion Dam was completed and water put into the New York Canal for the first time. 1910, the Pagemont Lumber Company becomes the Boise Lumber Company. 1915, Arrow Rock Dam was completed. That's the first large dam on the Boise River. 1925, Boise Lumber Company's closed. Property deed, 1932, changed hands, I think Mary mentioned several times, in between that period until Ada County assumed ownership due to tax forfeiture in 1977. 1976, those of us living in Idaho at the time remember the Teton Dam failure. That generated a whole lot of interest in the state's dams. And in 1978, after being notified for several years that there were some problems with Barber Dam safety, the governor declared the dam to be unsafe and work began on repair. In 2007, uncontrolled leakage was observed downstream near the powerhouse. That initiated repairs, and ongoing repairs were implemented in 2015 to repair the remainder of the total dam. So we'll get into some photographs here. This is pre-1932. I don't have a date on it. Here's the top of the existing dam as it looks today. This was a flashboard structure. You indicate the size. They insert up to 8 feet of flashboards, raise the water level behind the dam an additional 8 feet.
Yay.
look how big the reservoir is behind it. It really looks like, you know, it's like we're a Shakespeare Theater in there, huh? It was underwater.
It probably would have been.
It was.
Yeah.
Why don't you go on, Liz, and just sort through these. Here's a picture of the lumber mill, downstream tow. This piece of the dam still exists, and part of this block house is still there. The concrete house is still there today. Here's a picture looking kind of to the south of the lumber mill. This whole ridge line now is full of homes. Here's another picture looking upstream at the reservoir, probably toward the Shakespeare Theater.
Yeah.
And here's a picture of the reservoir full of logs. Here's the size of a guy walking the logs. In 1932, work was undertaken to repair pieces of the dam. As you can see, the timber crib with the timber facing on it. Anybody been up to Sun Valley and on Trail Creek Road, you look over, you've probably seen that timber crib dam there in Sun Valley. Real similar construction. There's another view. And I think that's 1930s. And here's a picture of 1974. As you can see, it's starting to come apart. Here's a letter from the governor's office. He was Governor Evans. Results of state inspection confirmed to the governor by the Army Corps of Engineers called the dam unsafe and indicated there was a high potential for failure at any time. So this was, by the way, 1 year after Ada County took ownership of the property. So that may have had something to do with it being declared unsafe. I don't know. Regardless, work began the fall of 78 to go ahead and make repairs to the dam. And again, you can see the timber crib structure. The inside was filled with rock, large rock and gravel. And it was at that time that the concrete face was sprayed on it. These are under drained so that any water that gets in behind or in the dam can drain out. We'll keep going. 2007, there was a leak that developed near the powerhouse downstream. Here's some dye that was placed upstream just to find out where the leak was, where the water was originating and where it was being dispersed. And there's as you can see, comes out here, you can see the dye in the water. It's a real fluorescent color dye. It doesn't take much to stain the water pretty clearly.
There's this one.
Oh,
they're looking still.
Yeah. These two guys have never been found. That's a joke. But I wouldn't recommend climbing into a whirlpool or adjacent to a whirlpool.
Oh, yeah.
Here's just downstream. This is one of the diversions off of the river, the Wright Canal. 2007. In 2008, construction began on repair. The next couple of slides just progress you through that. And at the tow tiebacks were installed, where you've got a steel rod that goes back into the tow, and then it's the dam is tied down into the subgrade. And that's what it looked like shortly after construction in time. As you can see, the sheet pile still has to be driven on the upstream side, but for all intents and purposes, the work was done at that time, just in time for the flows. 2009, that's what it looked like. June of 2013, this is from some of our inspection. 2015, when construction was resumed to repair the rest of the tow of the dam. And the next couple of pictures are just more of those. And at that time, as some of you may know, the reservoir was drawn down for construction. And one of the things with the turbines in the powerhouse is that if there's a disruption in power and they trip, they go offline, the gates close so the water doesn't go through the powerhouse when that happens. And if someone is there to notice that, they restart the system and you resume flow. On one particular instance, at about 11 o'clock, for whatever reason, the units tripped offline, and there's a call out to the operator to let him know. That didn't work. So for a period overnight in February 2015, there was no water going into the river for a period of about 6 hours. Water finally did rise to the crest of the spillway, flooded the construction works, and that's, I believe, when someone noticed, when they came on site and saw the equipment underwater. So I know the owners are working to prevent that from ever happening again. This is what it looked like during the last inspection following the, what's that called? Snowmageddon we had in 2017, and it behaved very well. There were flows in excess of 7,500 cubic feet per second over the spillway, which doesn't happen very often. So with that, I'll finish.
Got a question, Mary. Thank you all for your questions.